Hello, this is Kevin Bacon again, and I'm going to make a video for ladyowned, one of my channels that I subscribe to. She subscribes to me. We get comments back and forth quite regularly. She has a knife that she recently purchased, and it had some markings on it. It says R-I-C-A, and then Solingen, Germany. When I was in Europe, in the late 70s, early 80s, I bought a knife manufactured from Solingen, Germany. And this one is a stainless steel blade. It's shiny. I have never really tried to get a good edge on it. It seems to be a relatively well-built knife, but not horribly well-built. And judging from the sheath, and this, if nothing else, we look at the sheath. The sheath is riveted together several different places. There's no spacer, bolster in here, anything like that. It's nice, but I would call it a tourist trade knife. And I bought it over there as a collector piece because I, even back then, was interested in picking up knives. This is one of my first ones my sister bought for me way back when I was 11 or 12 years old. This one was manufactured by Western Manufacturing here in the United States. This blade is not stainless steel. It is, hard. I mean, this thing holds an edge like nobody's business. And if you look at it carefully, you don't have the best light in here, but there are some stains on the blade. Not too bad. I polished this up on my buffer wheel very, very well, so that it's shiny mostly. But now we're going to look at the sheath again. Okay, we have a few rivets on the sheath to hold it together. It is a molded sheath. The sheath was molded. If we look at the back, there's a good solid rivet right here to hold it together. Doesn't require spacer leather because of the shape of the molding of the leather. Good quality. I've carried this, several thousand miles. Tough, good, solid stuff. Okay, now here on the workbench is a knife my parents bought for me, made by the Olson Knife Manufacturing Company out of Howard City, Michigan. That knife company is no longer in business. This is a custom-made knife. The blade, very, very similar to the one that the design of the one that you have, and as you can see, if it's looking good, there's plenty of rust on this blade. So I'm going to show you how we're going to get rid of some of that rust. I've got some 800 grit wet dry paper here, and you could use fine steel wool. We want to find out what direction the buffing was done on this blade. In this case, the buffing was done up and down from top to bottom on the blade instead of longitudinally. I believe looking at the one you've got, it was done longitudinally. We want to follow that so that we keep the scratches the same way. Just take our sandpaper or fine steel wool and buff it back and forth across, and you can see a huge difference very quickly in this blade. And that will maintain the integrity of the original manufacturer. That blade, being probably carbon steel because it rusted, might be a decent quality. You see, it doesn't take very much to bring that back. Now, as for sharpening the knife, unless it's absolutely necessary, I don't sharpen a knife with a brick. Okay? And a lot of those two-sided stones are basically two-sided bricks. They're good for machetes, and they're good for hasty sharpening, but if you want to put an edge on a quality knife, then I suggest that you either use your 800 grit sandpaper and place it on a hard surface and draw the knife across it carefully until you get a sharp edge. And 800 grit will get you a pretty fair sharp edge. Or invest in an inexpensive couple of diamond hones. I got one at Harbor Freight that has four different stones in one. It's in here somewhere. A good medium fine diamond stone will put a good edge on it. And watching to be careful that you don't scuff up that nice shiny surface up here while you're putting your edge on it. So the utility stones, probably not the best idea. Okay, now we're going to look at that sheath. And your sheath was torn on the back and missing some stitching down the side here. So I would, if you want to maintain the same sheath so that it keeps its period nature, then I would get some good Dacron thread and restitch where the stitching has gone bad. Button thread works really well. But then I would go to the back where it's torn, and the leather itself is torn, so you've got a patch where the leather is torn. So I use, when I'm gluing up my sheaths to manufacturer sheath, I use the same glue that fabric workers use. So here's some right here. I use fabric glue. This is called Fabric Fusion. It is wonderful stuff. I don't know if this is any good after having frozen. It works still good after it's thawed out. So Fabric Fusion, and we're going to use it sparingly, but it dries clear. And the first thing I would say is to put a little Fabric Fusion on the edges where it overlaps, put it back together carefully, and then what I would do is cut a piece of material, nylon or canvas, some sort of material of that that's either similar in color to the sheath itself or black. And I would glue it to the back of the sheath, trimming it nicely so that it fit the entire back of the sheath, and then glue it down securely over the leather. And once that cures, put another coat. Unless this is we don't want to use cotton, because cotton will deteriorate in the weather or whatever. But if you use a nylon or a polyester, then glue it down, then trim it off very nicely, making sure that the edges are glued down smoothly. That will hold that together. And if it's nice black, it should look very nice. You know, just trim it off very nicely. Otherwise, you have to manufacture an entirely another sheath for that. Now, I looked on the internet for several hours, quite literally, because my internet was still giving me trouble, and I wanted to see if it was going to work or not, to see if I could find another one that would match that particular knife, and I could not. The interesting thing is that particular blade has a handle that is reminiscent of a German bayonet. And they were quite popular for a while in the 50s. Now remember that Germany changed its moniker stamp a couple of different times after World War II. West Germany was popular for a while. Then from West Germany, it went to DBR, which was Deutsches Bundesrepublik, and then FRG, the Federal Republic of Germany. So if it was being exported, instead of putting DBR on it, they would have put FRG. Since the words are in English, Western Germany, I would guess that it was an export to an English-speaking country before they started putting FRG on it. So that's going to make it back in the 50s, most likely. Not before that, obviously, because World War II, previous to World War II, it would have been Germany, all right, Deutschland. But not Western Germany, because there wasn't any such thing. Okay, so my guess is around the 50s. I got mine in the 70s, probably 79 or 80. And I really don't think we can get enough of a picture here, but I'll bring it up close. It is not likely to focus that close. It says, Solingen, it also says Rostfrei, which is rust-free, and then the name above it, I thought my glasses on, is just a little bit difficult for me to read. Let me get a glass. Actually, this camera is doing a better job bringing it in than I could see it with my glasses. There's a little C that's hardly there, and then it's J-U-L Herberts, Solingen Rust Free. So there you are, that's where it is. The problem with identifying these is there are so many manufacturers of knives in Solingen. It's like the knife-making capital of Western Europe. I can't tell you how good the blade is. It looks from its appearance as though it was ground, as though it might be decent steel. Now, as for a sharpening stone, any hardware store will have a small Washita stone cut from the Washita Mountains down here in Arkansas, or an Arkansas stone, that are fairly fine, not expensive at all. A couple dollars, you can buy a small stone that will put a fine edge on almost any knife. I have, easily half a dozen knives in my office that I have reprofiled and everything else from different sources. Some of them are so fine they're almost as smooth as glass to put that super fine edge, but I really don't think that that's necessary. A good utility edge on the blade, polish it up good with steel wool, and fix the sheath, and everything should be good to go. Anyway, that's it for now. Oh, one more thing. Bradley hammer video coming, but I gotta find them all because I use them in different places. Come back. Okay, here's a quick addendum to this video. The RICA is not RICA, it's R1CA. And it stands for Carbon Steel Canadian Belt Knife. It's the model number, not the manufacturer. So that would explain, the air quality is not so good here today. That would explain the rust on the blade and the fleur-de-lis because it was manufactured specifically to send to Canada. Okay, so that's that. And I forgot to say anything about the leather on the guard. The same thing with that. You can soak it with epoxy, clear epoxy, but I think fabric glue, if it were saturated with fabric glue and then pressed into shape and let dry,
it would probably do a good job. That fabric glue is kind of, is really, really tough stuff when it cures. Okay, just previously I said I had a bunch of knives in my office. Well, I do have a bunch of knives in my office, but I really meant that I had a bunch of sharpening stones in here. And I do. Okay. This is a diamond stone. Relatively inexpensive. You can buy it for $3 or $4. It's a medium. This one happens to be a Gerber, but there are several others out there just like it. Diamond hone. Do a phenomenal good job. Not expensive. Let's see here. Much more expensive, on the order of $20. This is a two-sided portable diamond stone. This one is made by Smith's. it has a fine side and a coarse side. Once again, phenomenal. Relatively expensive. Here's a small piece of Washita stone. It used to be a larger one. You can see it's kind of a tan-colored stone. It's quite fine. Take quite a while to get an edge on this, but once it gets there, it's pretty good. Here's a brick. It's two-sided. It's a good stone for getting a start if you're careful. I would stay off the coarse side unless the thing is really, really blunt. It'll really put scratches in. The fine side's not too bad. I would get it wet. Here's a big Arkansas stone, Washita. It used to look like this with all the chips and everything on it. And then I resurfaced it with a carborundum stone and then polished it down so that it's nice and flat on this side. In this box, this is a much, much finer stone. It is, I resurfaced it also. I don't know what it is. It's gray, but it'll put, oh my, close to a razor edge on the blade after you've done all the other steps. And I've got, if I dug around here, I'd find four or five other ones. They're here in various different places. And so there's a lot of options out there. But it doesn't have to be a real expensive stone, but it ought to be a fairly fine stone to put that last edge on. Otherwise, you're going to have a really, really coarse edge. Okay, that's that. I published this video already once in HD, but it was choppy and missed a whole bunch of the audio. So I'm going to try publishing it now in medium, and we'll see how that comes out. Ken Bacon, once again, bye.